on break this summer, as you all know. But you're welcome to read through Colossians on your own. Friday night, young adult study will be tentatively... Can you mute my guitar just in case I keep hitting it? More?
Yeah.
Number eight. Technical. So we're going to try to meet the last... at least one more Friday, depending on how things go, but people are on vacation and we have people in from out of town. So we'll see what you guys want to do. And then, what's that one?
What?
Is that the location?
Of what?
It's okay. It's all right. And then I guess the last bullet point, I'm going to be moving to Idaho.
God shuts that door. You know. God could still shut the door.
Amen.
Right?
Tentatively, I'm moving. Potentially my last Sunday would be the 26th or 24th, of July.
Of December 20th.
Because it does say on there the last Sunday is the 24th. It doesn't say
25th.
What month.
I think the year is
25th.
Like that.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So we'll see. It's been a pleasure. Yeah, we can do that on the 24th. Maybe by then I'll have the announcements down. You know, it'll be smooth. It's all right. Thank you for joining us today. Again, there's coffee and donuts in the kitchen. Bathrooms are out. Go to your left and then your right. Tithe box is over. By the side door, and I think that's it. Yeah, all right. Lord, thank you that we can gather and give us wisdom in all of our decisions, and give us peace with all the turmoil in the world, and help us to understand your word and to make it a part of our life, that we may serve you more, and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Scott. Chris, it was great having you back leading worship. There he is. And then he's going to England on Tuesday. So he won't be with us for a while, but good to have all you guys back. We'll see you later. Something like that. See you. Okay, that was bad. Okay, we dove deep into the two shortest books in the New Testament, and God put it on our hearts to dig deep into the two longest books of the New Testament, the Gospel of Luke and the Book of Acts. And Luke was, we found out, a Gentile, but this is going to be a deep dive into the Gospel. We are going to go deep. We are going to understand things about Jesus that maybe we have passed by. And I don't care if you're a seasoned saint or if you're a brand new believer, we're going to get a glimpse of the man, Jesus, who is really God incarnate. And it is going to be an amazing journey. I am so excited. There's nothing more important to study than his story, right? I think that's where we got history. Over 50% of Luke's gospel is unique only to Luke. It's not found anywhere else in the Bible. And 2 weeks ago, we found out, obviously, he's a Gentile. He was a doctor. Luke was saved when Paul preached at Antioch on his first mission trip. And then he was discipled by Paul for a year. Paul stayed in Antioch for a year. So Luke was really cut his teeth in Christianity with Paul's discipleship. And Luke then accompanied Paul through the rest of his life. The second, third, and fourth mission trips all the way back. I'm going to skip that. All right. By the way, they did go to Rhodes, and Rhodes is one of the seventh wonders of the ancient world. Have you heard of the Colossus of Rhodes? Okay, it's that giant statue. Look at that. And the ships would enter the harbor sailing at underneath that statue where he's, like, traversing the harbor entrance. It's pretty amazing. It was only ruins when Paul went there, but they were still there. So it was quite an amazing journey. All right, even everyone near the end abandoned Paul except Luke. And remember, Paul had a thorn in the flesh. Do you remember that? And he prayed three times, God, heal me. And God said, my grace is sufficient to you. He wasn't going to heal him. And Luke, being a doctor, I believe that's one of the reasons why he stuck with Paul. It was part of his ministry, not only to glean from Paul, but to help Paul in whatever infirmity that was. Luke stayed with them. In fact, 2 Timothy 4:9 and 10 says, make every effort to come to me soon. For Demas, having loved this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica. Crescens has gone to Galatia, and Titus to Dalmatia. They breed Dalmatians there. No, I don't know if they do. That's bad. Only Luke stayed with me. Everybody else left. So he's saying, now pick up Mark and bring him with you, for he is useful for me for service. And by the way, service is ministry. So Luke was a Gentile convert under Paul's first mission trip. He was educated. He was a physician, someone who wanted to know the exact truth about Jesus. I want you to get this picture. Luke is a pagan doctor. He is really tight with Rome and all the elites of Rome, because doctors back then were really elevated to a really high esteem. And so he was friends with governors and senators, and it would be like somebody in Washington, D.C. that kind of rubbed shoulders with the president and with the senators and all of that, who's a well-known, respected, educated physician. And he comes to the Lord, and he says, you know what? There's all these accounts. I want to know exactly who this Jesus is who claims to be the Son of God. And Luke researches it out carefully to know the exact truth. Who is this man? He probably is claiming to be the Son of God. The Old Testament, and 2 weeks ago we figured this out, ends with this, Malachi 4:5. Behold, I'm going to send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and terrible day of the Lord. And Luke is the only gospel that takes off where the Old Testament leaves off. And so Luke will find, as we get into chapter 1, is going to talk about John the Baptist, who really prophesied in the power of Elijah. And in fact, Jesus said in Matthew 11:13, if you're willing to accept it, John himself is Elijah who is to come. So the Old Testament ends, I love this, with the prophet saying Elijah is going to come before the Messiah, before the day of the Lord. And now John the Baptist is that spirit of Elijah prophesying. And we'll get into that next week. Luke finished Acts around 63 AD, so he must have finished the Gospel of Luke much earlier. Luke was likely written in the early 60s, late 50s. Sometime after the events described in Acts 28, but before two major events that aren't mentioned yet, Paul's martyrdom in 64-65 AD under Nero. And by the way, Nero started persecuting Christians in 64 AD, killing them in horrible ways, and the destruction of the temple. So all the Gospels had to be written prior to the destruction of the temple, all of them. You know, some liberal scholars try to say, oh, it was written, you know, centuries after, but now we have manuscript evidence that are within 20 to 30 years, fragments of the Gospels that of Jesus' life. So we know that it was early. In fact, if you open your Bibles, go ahead and do it to the Gospel of Luke. Today we're going to cover verses 1 through 4. And these particular verses are written in classical Greek, not Koine Greek. So if you've ever studied Greek, The whole New Testament, except for portions of Luke, are written in Koine Greek. That is the slang Greek of the day. Classical Greek was reserved for the elites and the Senate and the scholars of the day. And Luke starts his gospel in classical Greek. He's the only gospel writer that does that. And then he moves sections to Koine Greek so that the common man will really get what he's trying to say, and the elites know what it is too. All right, so verses 1 through 4, let's just dive in. Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile an account of the things accomplished among us, just as they were handed down to us by those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and servants of the word, it seemed fitting to me as well, having investigated everything carefully from the beginning, to write it out for you in consecutive order, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know the exact truth about the things which you have been taught. Luke utilizes four sources in his investigation. As he's doing research on who this Jesus is, he utilizes four, and they're all in the text that we just read. Let's just look at it. Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile an account of the things accomplished among us. So the first one is written accounts. And there were several. There are the Gnostic Gospels. You've probably heard of those. They could have been already in circulation. Matthew and Mark were already written, and we'll talk about that in a minute. Verse 2. Just as they were handed down to us, oral tradition or oral accounts, by those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses, eyewitness testimony number 3, and servants or ministers of the word, the fourth source that he utilized. So what he did, written accounts, Mark and Matthew. Eusebius, who was an early church father, dates Matthew's gospel about 41 A.D. And he didn't write too far long after John the Baptist died. Oral accounts. People who heard what happened but didn't personally see it. You know, hey, man, I was living in the outskirts of Jerusalem, and I heard that Jesus was crucified, and 3 days later I heard many people saw him. I didn't see him, but the people that saw him were reliable witnesses. They're people that didn't actually witness it but heard about it and passed down to Luke as Luke investigated and interviewed all the people around there. That's why he has so much more depth than Matthew, Mark, or John, because Luke talked to the witnesses. He investigated it. Number 3, eyewitness testimony. People that actually saw it. And we know Paul mentioned 500 people saw the risen Christ. Okay, that was probably a ballpark number. A whole bunch of people saw the risen Lord, probably more than 500. And Luke found those people and interrogated them and researched and investigated and witnessed. Number 4, the ministers of the word, most likely the apostles and Paul. So these four sources provide the backdrop for the gospel of Luke. Luke not only was inspired by God to write, and we must remember that. Liberal scholars and higher textual criticism, the critics, try to negate the inspiration of the Word of God. Folks, God moved men by the Holy Spirit to write the Bible. You know, they'll say, well, there's a document Q that they all borrowed from, and they were just copying what they saw in this mysterious document Q, you know. No, God moved them. He inspired them. They didn't need a document, and that's why we have four gospel accounts, and there are many places where they contradict, not many, but some, and we're going to go through those as we go through the gospel. The event is recorded accurately, but when the event occurs, oftentimes is different in the gospels. Luke chapter 1, verse 3. It seemed fitting for me as well, having investigated everything carefully from the beginning, to write it out for you in consecutive order, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know the exact truth about the things which have been taught. Luke was a true historian, or rather his Victorian. Just like to say that. And he wrote the Gospel of Luke in consecutive order. What that means is where there are variances, and there are, between Matthew and Mark, or Mark and Luke, or Luke and Matthew, where there are differences, Luke is the measure, the standard that God inspired this Gentile physician to carefully investigate and write it out in consecutive order. There should be no debate, and scholars and pastors and theologians debate, well, who's right? You know, was Matthew right? God told us quite clearly, hey, I gave you Luke, Gentile church. He's a Gentile like you. He's a doctor. He's a learned man. He investigated, and I told him to tell you this is the correct order. So we always go to Luke to find out the exact truth. In fact, one example, Matthew places the healing of the centurion's servant. Remember the centurion? Hey, he was a God-fearing Gentile, right? Much like Theophilus, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute. But, man, he goes, Jesus, I know if you just say the word, hey, my child will be healed because I, too, command many people. So Matthew puts the healing of the centurion's servant, not my child's servant, before the disciples' controversial plucking of the grain on the Sabbath. Remember that? And Jesus healing the man's withered hand. However, Luke places the healing of the centurion's servant after those two events. So when did it actually happen? We know exactly. Luke wrote it in chronological order. Matthew never claimed to. Matthew thematically presented the life of Christ through themes in his book, but Luke, God said, write in chronological order the exact truth of the events that occurred. There should be no debate, yet you can read commentaries. Well, you know, so-and-so thinks maybe Matthew was right. No, Luke was right. God tells us right there. Yes, in our journey through Luke, we will address the chronologies that differ and what theologians call the synoptic problem. Have you ever heard of that? Anybody who said it? Okay. So Matthew, Mark, and Luke are the synoptic gospels. What that means is that you can view them together. So the optic is viewing and sin, it's together, synonyms kind of like that. And so the idea, you can put them in three parallel columns, and there will be some differences, which we'll get into. Who is Luke and Acts written to? Some guy named the most excellent Theophilus. Most excellent there in the Greek, the Thayer's, that's the lexical Greek dictionary, says mightiest, strongest, noblest, most illustrious, best, most excellent, used in addressing men of prominent rank or office. In fact, in the Bible, it's only used four times. And all four times, it's talking about a governor. In fact, Luke chapter 1, verse 3, we know Theophilus, most excellent, but he doesn't say what office he held, but it had to be an office. Because we know Acts 23, 26, Claudius Lysias, to the most excellent governor, Felix, greetings to you. Acts 24:3, we acknowledge this in every way and everywhere, most excellent Felix, with all thanksgiving. And Paul said, I am not out of my mind, most excellent Festus, but I utter words of sober truth. This phrase is unique only for governors or senators or men who hold high office in the Roman government. So most excellent is really almost like a title. Theophilus is two Greek words. You can probably pick them out. Theos, which is the Greek word for God, and philos, which is friend or friendship kind of love. So Theophilus, his name would mean friend of God. With the title of most excellent, most likely this was a Roman senator or governor, and most likely he was a God-fearer or friend of God, just like the Roman centurion, Acts 10:1. Now, there was a man at Caesarea named Cornelius, a centurion of what was called the Italian cohort, a devout man and one who feared God with all his household and gave many alms to the Jewish people and prayed to God continually. Don't you love that? that there were God-fearers all over the world. They couldn't do everything that the Jews did, and they were waiting for a Messiah, a Christ, to come where Gentiles could be grafted in and take part in that beautiful worship and service of God. We have to capture the magnitude and significance of this, who this is written to. Luke wrote more of the New Testament than any other author, including Paul. Most of the New Testament was written by a Gentile physician. I love that. God had a Gentile doctor in these two books write to a Roman politician. Do you think God was trying to get a point across? You know, had the New Testament just been written by all Jewish guys, it would be easy to theorize, well, it was just a conspiracy. They so wanted the Messiah that they fabricated all of this about Jesus so they would have. Luke was an educated physician who wrote to a Roman politician and researched and gave us, I believe, the greatest gospel and the only record of the early church and the spread of Christianity, Acts. No one else recorded it. They had no stake in Judaism or their Messiah. They had no reason to conspire or embellish what Jesus accomplished while he was on earth. The Gospel of Luke is an unbiased, researched account of the man claiming to be the Son of God. It is trustworthy in all it says. And Acts is the record of the birth of the church and the spread of Christianity. But you would think that Luke would have addressed this book to all of mankind. You know, it's like, man, I've investigated this. And, man, to the whole Roman world, who they believe they conquered the whole world by then, you know. So all of that, or some specific group of people. But he wrote it to one person, a Roman politician. God cares about individuals. You know, he wrote most of the new guy, this Roman politician. The little letters we did, remember, 2 John was written to one lady. Remember this, Theophilus became a Christian, I believe, and lost his title. He lost whatever position he had, be it governor or senator. Christians couldn't hold public office in Rome. And in Acts, this is volume 2, Luke is volume 1, Acts is volume 2, Theophilus loses his title. So he starts Acts like this. The first account I composed, Theophilus, about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. So Theophilus gave up everything. I believe this is a clear indication he became a Christian, a real believer. So back to our text, verse 4. So that you may know the exact truth about the things you have been taught. And folks, we don't serve a God who's a myth. You know, the Bible is the most authenticated book of all the religious writings in the world. It is the only book that doesn't have these fanciful things, but it has real history of real people that lived in real locations and real events that occurred, and more than that, prophecy that was fulfilled 100% in every way. There must have been a debate between the discrepancies between Matthew and Mark's Gospels. That's called the synoptic problem. So people were probably reading saying, okay, why does Matthew put it here and Mark puts it here? The cool thing about that is no one changed it. You know, Resurrection Sunday morning, we have three vastly different accounts of what occurred that Sunday. No one edited the Bible and said, well, man, we gotta harmonize all these discrepancies. No one did that. Who are we going to rely on most? Luke, because God had him write chronologically and the exact truth. Why did God do that? Because he allowed Matthew and Mark and John to write from their recollection And to write it out like that, and so that years later, when people who know eyewitness testimonies, if they all line up 100%, there's conspiracy. Right, Mike? But if they aren't lined up 100%, okay, now this is real testimony. And then God gives us Luke to say, okay, there's some discrepancies, but I gave Luke the exact truth. Are you with me? Okay, so that is why I'm so excited to study. So Dr. Luke is going to solve the problem by researching everything carefully and give us the exact truth of what took place. And he is writing to a Roman senator or governor, politician. He can't make a mistake. You know, these guys, if you write a false history, when kind of in their charge, you could be put to death. So it had to be researched carefully. He will synchronize the synoptics for us. And we have an historically accurate account of the life of Jesus and the birth of the church in the Gospel of Luke to know the exact truth. You know, Christianity is the only religion based on historical facts. Not myths, not ideologies, not philosophy. And there's a lot of philosophies. And in fact, most false religions are more a philosophical system rather than a true religion. Faith is built on facts. You know what I always say. Faith equals what? Belief plus proof. If you weren't here for our Easter service, go online to our website to watch it, because we went through all the extra biblical accounts of Jesus Christ. And they all affirm, in fact, even the Jewish Midrash, affirm that Jesus did miracles, that he lived, that he was born by Mary, that he was pronounced to crucifixion by Pontius Pilate, and that reportedly he rose from the dead. These are extra-biblical pagan historians that wrote that, and the Jewish Midrash. Oh, and that he did miracles. In fact, the Midrash just said that he did sorceries. But those were the miracles that he did. Jesus loves you this morning. Do you know that? You are loved by God no matter how you failed God. The gospel, you know what it means, good news. The good news is we all fail miserably, but God forgives us. And Jesus paid for our faults on the cross. And you are forgiven, and he loves you no matter how you fail him. He loves you so much. I find it interesting that the shortest book of the New Testament, 2 John, is written to one person, the chosen lady and her children. And the two longest books are written to one person. God cares about individuals. He cares about you. He knows the very numbers of hair on your head. He knows the challenges you're facing. He knows when you're in a crowd and you feel completely lonely, like no one gets you, no one understands, no one cares. He knows everything about you and loves you, and you are the apple of his eye. That is the greatest truth that the gospel message brings. That God himself, creator of all things, writer of our DNA code, came to earth, the kenosis, emptied himself, and became a man so that he could know you, know everything about you, and love you, and hold you and help you through all of life's challenges. John 16:27, it says, "For the Father himself loves you, because you have loved me and have believed that I have come forth from the Father." And Jesus wants to bring you through all of life's challenges and blessings. Revelation 3:19, it says, "Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline." I don't like that part. But it does keep me on the narrow path. If you've ever experienced the discipline of the Lord, you know, okay, Lord, I want to stay on this narrow path so you can just shower me in blessings and love. And because when I get off, there's that fear. And we only fear one thing, the discipline of the Lord. That's all I fear in life, not battle. "Oh, those I love, therefore be zealous and repent, turn and get on the narrow path. And then Jesus said, I love this. Written to the church, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come into him and dine with him and he with me, that intimate fellowship with God. I remember there was a year that I didn't hear from the Lord. My back was really bad. I was walking with a cane. I was teaching Bible college at Calvary Chapel. And just the pain of my back, if you've ever had back pain, Pastor Chris, I know you know, and several of you, this was excruciating pain. Never got relief. And then, further, for a year, I never heard from God. I mean, I would pray, and it's like, Lord, you know, what do you want me to teach? And I would get nothing. It was just like, you know, the connection with God was closed. That ever happened to you? You know, this was a year. I had no connection. At worship service, I would, like, try to feel the Spirit or enter into that place of where I'm worshiping my God and my King with my heart, and I couldn't do it for a year. And I remember I'm in the jacuzzi. I had to take about 4 jacuzzis a day and take a whole bunch of drugs from my back because it was the only relief I could get. And I'm in there, and I'm crying, and I'm like, God, I haven't heard from you in so long. And all of a sudden, I got this original thought stream. You were a Jedediah. And I'm like, I'm a mountain man, you know. And then I looked it up in the Bible. It's in the Bible one place. David named his son Solomon. But the prophet said, no, his name is Jedediah, and it means beloved of God. And I wept, and I finally heard from God. Listen, if you feel distant from the Lord, don't give up. Theologians call that the dark night of the soul. The dark night of the soul is when you feel disconnected from God. You're doing everything you can, but it's just like you don't have that. Folks, you'll get through it. Just stay the course. You'll get through it, and God will speak to you powerfully. Worship team, come on up. Did Scott move to Idaho already? We are going to get to know Jesus better as we read about his life, death, and resurrection and study the gospel of Jesus Christ. I believe we're going to get a picture of our loving Savior that is just going to revolutionize. Someone want to go get Scott? Know this, too, that if you feel alone this morning, you know, the saddest thing I have ever heard is on this blog online I read this past week. This person had been going to this church for years, and they said they never really connected with anyone in the church. And they, even in church, they felt alone. When surrounded by people, they just...
That can't be. The gospel... Oh, my mic just died. Did you mute me?
Check, check. Oh, there we go.
No, it's on.
Oh, yeah. But they said, I just felt alone. And, you know, it's very interesting. This particular person said, you know what, someone told him, you're never alone. The Holy Spirit's with you. Jesus is with you. So he started practicing the presence of the Lord. You know what I mean? And so every time he felt alone, he's like, Jesus, I know you're with me. And I know you're right here with me to comfort me. And I love you, Jesus. And all of a sudden, as he got his eyes off of, well, nobody likes me. Oh, I'm so alone. And fixed them on Jesus. All of a sudden, people at church started coming around him and connecting with him and all this stuff. You see the idea? If this is right, this will be okay as well. Does that make sense? Yeah, so whatever you're facing, run to the Lord. And we're going to spend quite some time going through the most magnificent gospel, I think. and really get a picture of who Jesus is. Are we all set? Okay, so I'm not going to record it then if your guitar is not working. God bless you guys watching online.
Let's stand to the next song. It's called The Blessing. And